welcome. All right, good afternoon, everybody. Just before I get rolling here, a couple of rules of engagement. I grew up in New York City. I live in Boston. So I've been socialized my entire life never to complete a sentence or a thought, so please interrupt. On top of that, I have three teenagers at home, so I not only have socialized that way, I've been conditioned that way never to complete a thought and or a sentence. And the other thing is, if you're not interrupting, I can't tell if you're listening, so please interrupt. And you know, maybe a prize to the person who interrupts first. The other thing is, apropos of homework, so part of the reason I sent out an assignment is I thought, you know, if I start with a little bit of pre-read, we don't have to level up real time. Also create some animosity, so you want to interrupt again. So I think there's a pretty solid theme here of please interrupt. And to the Admiral's admonition, maybe by the time we're done, you all have had at least a chance to think about one opportunity to apply what we're talking about this afternoon, this evening, personally in your next command. And to the point of learning, and I'll get into the high velocity element of it, and as you know, if you go to work and wear a bow tie all the time, you think you're teaching. And you may be teaching, right? Because you're standing up and telling people what you think is right and wrong and that kind of thing, what you think is true and false. Learning isn't evident until someone actually does something differently. If they don't do anything differently, you haven't taught, well, you may think you've taught, but you haven't learned anything at all. So to the Admiral's admonition to think through how to apply this personally and in command, it's not exactly applying it, but if you walk out the door with an idea, then maybe we have actually accomplished a little bit of learning. And if you walk out the door without any ideas, all I've done is hopefully been entertaining, but not necessarily good teaching. So anyway, rules of engagement, please interrupt, and by the time we're done, have something actionable to do. In terms of theme of today, I had a chance to read through the Design for Maintaining Maritime Supremacy, and it, you know, it goes something like this, which is the world is increasingly varied in terms of its challenges. It's faster moving. We can use technology maybe as a necessity to do the work we do, but it's not sufficient in terms of competing and staying competitively ahead. Now that was in the CNO's design, but if you read that, that could fit in any statement by the leader of a leading industrial organization. That it is fundamentally, the world is getting more complex, the world is getting faster moving, technology is a necessity, but it's insufficient, and what really makes the difference between good and great, between those who trail in the pack and those who lead the pack and continue to lead the pack, is what they do with all that technology. So I'll go into this issue of recognizing threats and opportunities, how you do that, and how you develop solutions on a continuing basis, but a little bit of personal background. So I got started into this whole field of high-velocity learning because of Toyota. And for a very simple reason, Toyota was essentially a non-presence in the U.S. auto market through the 50s and 60s. And the 70s was sort of an afterthought that if you wanted to buy a car which was small, compact, fuel-efficient, you bought a Toyota. And it wasn't until the 1980s where Toyota started going off its platform of subcompacts into mid-sized cars that it had real impact on the U.S. auto industry. And the reason it had such huge impact on the U.S. auto industry in the 80s, not the 70s, is in the 70s, when Toyota was selling small subcompact cars, the big three, in particular Roger Smith at General Motors, said, psh, you know, who can possibly make money selling small subcompact cars? The margins are so slim. We'll leave that to the Japanese. They can chase after the last grain of rice in the rice bowl, as it were, and we'll make money on the mid-sized stuff and the bigger stuff. Well, wouldn't you know, by the 1980s, Toyota was selling a car which was a bit more fairly priced than what the big three could do. Their reliability was somewhere between 100x and 1000x better. They were bringing major model upgrades on a 2-year clip when everyone else in the world was bringing it on a 4-year clip, and they started eating into the mid-market. And so if you look at the sales of the Ford Taurus, for example, they were very good, you know, and growing when the car was introduced. It hit a very high plateau as the best-selling mid-sized car in the country. And then the Camry came out. Then the Camry came out 2 years later, and the Ford was still the same old Ford because it was on a 4-year update. And then the Ford came up, but it was, again, a cycle or two behind the Toyota, and it sales then down, 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 and finally Ford had to cancel and discontinue the Taurus as a brand because it couldn't compete with Toyota. So I got interested in what was going on with Toyota as to how, in a hyper-competitive industry, they managed to come from way behind, catch up, get ahead, and continue to stay ahead. And if you have questions, we can go more into, you know, the specific of staying ahead in that industry. But let me just quantify some of the advantages for those who stay ahead. So in the auto industry, and again, I'll pick two industries which are about the most competitive in the world, the auto industry and the consumer electronics industry. Those are industries where if you make something, there's probably three, four, five other folks who make nearly the identical thing. They're trying to sell into exactly the same market space, and they're competing everywhere. And not only are they competing everywhere with you, you can gain essentially no advantage because your suppliers will sell to them and your customers will buy from them. All that said, when Toyota goes to sell a car, they make about $2,700 per unit. Ford is number two at about $900 per unit. General Motors is somewhere up there, I guess, what, about $800, $600 per unit. Again, doing exactly the same work, Toyota's getting 3, 4, 5x return relative to their competitors. Now, when I was giving a talk earlier this week, I guess on Tuesday, to a group of doctors, and we started going through the conversation about what does it mean to make more per unit than anybody else? And where we got the conversation going is, why would you pay more for something? And the answer came down to the fact that when you buy it, you get more joy out of the experience of owning it and using it than if you bought and used something else. So somehow Toyota has figured out how to bring more joy to its customers than its competitors. Then we said, you know, well, where do you get, that's the revenue side, where do you get the other advantages in terms of profit per unit? We said, well, you know, part of it might be revenue and part of it might be expenses. And so the doctors started saying, well, you know, it's really about efficiency, it's about less waste, all this and that. And we kept pushing back on that proposition because efficiency is not a causal variable, it's an outcome. You can measure efficiency, right? But you can't use efficiency to cause anything, it's the result of something else. And then they said, well, it's not efficiency, it's less waste, which to me sounded like the same thing, but I'm not an English major. But again, you know, less waste is the result of something, it's not the cause of something. And then we kept going with that. And they finally realized that if you can bring more joy to people, they'll pay more for your product. And if you can do it more efficiently, it's because when you go to do your work, and your work might involve thousands of people and, you know, tens of thousands of engineering days worth of work, that when you do your work, you're doing with more grace and more elegance than anybody else doing the same work as you. So anyway, at least with doctors, when I tell this story, I say, oh, we don't make cars. Actually, it turns out making cars is really hard to do. It's easier than treating acne, but, you know, every doctor, it's funny, you deal with doctors, they all think of their careers as the opening credits in ER. And you know, and they treat acne. But if you really think about these differences, it's the ability to bring more joy into the marketplace and do it with greater grace and elegance. Now, Toyota is not the only company that can pull this off. So in the world of a consumer electronics, Apple competes head-to-head with its rivals, much like Toyota does. And in the case of smartphones, Apple sells 1/5 of smartphones in the world. It seems like a lot. But in terms of profitability, they enjoy 92% of the world smartphone market profitability. I mean, it's a crazy difference. And that head nod you gave is exactly one I gave when I read the Wall Street Journal about that. 20% of sales and 92% of profits. Now, for what it's worth, Samsung gets the 15%. And for the folks in the room saying, how can a guy from MIT at 92 and 15 get more than 100? It's because everyone else who makes a smartphone actually loses money when they sell it. I'm not sure the business model, but they do. All right, so 92% of the profit. Now, you get into the conversation as to why Apple must be so much more profitable selling smartphones, and it gets back to this issue of joy again. Because when you pick up an iPhone and you turn it turns on the first button. It doesn't come with a manual. When you connect it to your computer, everything connects. All your electronic media is on your iPhone and on your computer and on your tablet and so on and so forth, and it's everywhere in the cloud. And when you pick up anything else, it doesn't have exactly the same sense of bringing joy to the user. And so when users think of buying an iPhone, a smartphone, and they think about an iPhone, it's like, hey, honey, can we get to the Apple store to be first in line? Will we get there before they run out? And when you start thinking about buying an Android phone, it's, hey, honey, check eBay, are they on discount? All right, so that's the difference. That's the competitive difference in the industrial world. Now, we'll skip Intel for a second, but here's something which is quite different from your world. So recently, I was watching that series Carrier about the Nimitz with my son, and in one of the opening scenes, they have the Command Master Chief of the Nimitz. And he's saying, and when this was filmed, he said, the United States has, I think at the time, 12 aircraft carriers, 10 of them are nuclear. And in fact, in the entire world, there are only 10 nuclear aircraft carriers, and I'm the command master chief of one of them. I'm one of 10 guys in the entire world. Now here's the thing, is that no one else has a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier. I mean, that's a huge competitive advantage from my perspective. I mean, I was watching the video, it said so. Here's the thing about the industrial world. No one has the equivalent of a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier and strike groups and that sort of thing. When you go to make a car and buy a coil of steel, it's exactly the same coil of steel as anybody else can buy. When you go to buy aluminum ingot, the ingot you get is exactly the same as anybody else. They can buy exactly the same aluminum ingot. If you go to buy plastic pellets for injection molding, it's the same plastic pellets as anyone else can get. If you buy equipment, a CNC machine, a press, a clean room, it's exactly the same as anyone else can buy. Now, here's an advantage you have over the world of some of my industrial colleagues. This whole idea of if you buy something, your competitor can get it, for us, we call that good business sense. You call it espionage and treason. I mean, you actually arrest people for doing that stuff. We pat them on the back and said, go to it, keep doing that. All right, now here's the thing about this world, though. If espionage and treason are okay, and everyone has the same stuff as everybody else, then the only possible difference in terms of getting these really outsized rewards for doing exactly the same work has to be the person using the stuff. And it's these folks who are giving you the advantage. And it's not only the folks using the stuff, but when we start thinking about product, for example, you know, in the auto companies, they advertise the car. But for instance, the person who's going to buy a BMW of this type, I was counting just before, they have about four or five different choices or alternatives when they go to look at that car. They can buy this car, they can buy the Jaguar version, they can buy the Mercedes version, they can buy the Cadillac version, the Lexus version. They got a lot of choice. And so if you want to sell a car, the focus really has to be beyond the car. It has to be the person who's going to drive the car. And understanding that person and how that person will appreciate your product and how they will define joy so that their first choice is your car and not someone else's car. All right, so this is the industrial world, which is, it is crazy competitive. There are outsized rewards for being better than anybody else, and being better can't be purchased. It simply cannot be purchased because anything you can buy in the industrial world, someone else can buy it too. So the only thing left is what people do with the stuff that's bought. So anyway, the rest of my presentation is really about this, what people do with the stuff they buy. And I think it connects into these initiatives in the CNO's design, both the green box of the learning piece, the high velocity learning piece, and also the gold box, which is about the leadership piece. So anyway, let me just step out of the industrial world for a second and talk about people who are good learners. And this is the world of healthcare. Now, healthcare also is one of these settings where you can get just absolutely blown away by the science and technology. But at the beginning of the day, the middle of the day, and the end of the day, it's not really the technology which is the key. It's understanding the needs of this person in the hospital bed. And when we look at clinicians and ask how they go about trying to understand the needs of the person in the hospital bed, the first thing they do is they monitor very, very closely. Because the folks in the healthcare community have gone to great efforts to define what they call normal, 98.6, 120 over 70, a whole bunch of different measures for blood chemistry. They've gone to all these great efforts to define normal. And then when they're concerned about the well-being of another human being, what they do is they monitor very closely to see abnormal. And the reason they monitor very closely to see abnormal is they understand that if there's an abnormality, they want to swarm on that abnormality sooner than later, so that the patient's condition doesn't deteriorate, and so that the patient's condition can be restored more easily, more effectively. And we've all heard the horror stories of denial of care or delay of care, where a patient had a condition which may have started as minor, both in terms of presentation and of treatment, but because it had a chance to snowball, the patient's condition got to the point it was actually very hard to contain and very hard to correct. So, you know, two key behaviors in the healthcare sector are, one, the system you're responsible for, you have to monitor it very closely to see when it goes abnormal. And when it goes abnormal, you have to get on that system and on the problem very, very quickly, both to contain the problem and understand why the problem is occurring. So two key behaviors. And it's not surprising that if you go into a hospital setting, the doctors and nurses and pharmacists and others wear very comfortable shoes because they're often running one place to the next. Seeing a problem and then swarming on it to understand, from that, there's an understanding which arises, right? Because the patient who's sitting in a bed, unmonitored, you don't really know what's going on. When you monitor the patient and an abnormality is indicated, you've gained some understanding into that patient's situation, which you lacked before. When you swarm onto the patient and start trying to understand why they're presenting in the way they're presenting, you've generated new additional knowledge. So a third critical behavior that's trained onto clinicians is to explain to their colleagues what they've discovered, either in terms of the nature of the problem's presentation or the nature of the causes that seem to cause the presentation, or if they've been treating the patient, the consequences of the treatments they've been using. And those become the three critical behaviors of dealing with this complex, dynamic, constantly changing system of the biology of a human being. Now, it turns out that the folks who are really good in the industrial world, they do exactly the same thing. So I'll give you an example here. I've done a lot of work over the years, going back to the late 1990s, I guess, with Alcoa. And Alcoa, you guys are in the business of harming other people when necessary and asked to do so. They're in the business of doing some stuff that also has the potential to harm other human beings. You may actually want to benchmark them and see if you're missing an angle on this one. Because they start in equatorial countries and they dig up the ground, which is dangerous in itself. And then they take all that loose stuff and load it onto trucks and drive it around. And that's dangerous in itself. And then they have to ship this stuff to places which have cheap electricity. And the shipping is dangerous in and of itself because you got to load and unload the boats. And then they put it in containers. They call it pots. It sounds so like you're going to make minestrone soup, but I'm trying to think of the volume of a pot. I guess if you did the volume of this stage, that would be about the volume of a pot in which you put their raw material. And then you take two things which are about the size of a telephone poles, pop them in, and run current through it. And the purpose of that is to kick off the oxygen from the compound so you're left with molten aluminum. All right, so you got in that one little situation, you've got mass and heat and electricity. The only thing they don't have is nuclear and biological, and I think biological is illegal and nuclear you guys own. But other than that, they've got just about every form of energy by which you can dismember a human being. And then when they have this molten metal, what do they do with it? Rather than keeping it in a pot, they pour it out. So now you've got running molten metal, which you're trying to put into an ingot and then give it shape. And when you give it shape, and for that moment where it's just a nice little happy ingot, then what you do is you start squeezing it through an anvil so that you add shape to it. But it's like toothpaste coming out of a tube, a little squeeze on one end, you got a lot of velocity of something which is heavy and sharp. So anyway, that's the work environment of Alcoa. And if doing what you all do is not thrilling enough, you know, you're welcome to come to one of these plants. But anyway, with that as a setup, it's not surprising that the chance of getting hurt on the job at Alcoa was meaningful. And so in 1987, when they took a measure on this, the chance of getting hurt on the job at Alcoa was about 2% a year, which is somewhat better than most of American industry, but still significant. So in a room this large, we'd need about four or five people in this room to volunteer to get hurt in the next 12 months. Any volunteers? No, come on, you have to understand, in industry at least, there's a lot of accounting and you have to make your numbers. We need four volunteers. All right, well, here's the thing. Let's switch this around. If we don't get volunteers to get hurt, at least someone volunteer to make the phone call at the end of the day. The phone call goes something like this. What's your name with the red tie? Right here. Yeah. Chris? Oh, two red ties. All right, so who wants to volunteer to call? You married? All right, who wants to volunteer to call Chris's spouse with a conversation which goes something like this? What's your spouse's name? Bota? Bota, I've got terrible news. I'm really sorry, but something terrible happened to Chris today. Anyone want to make that phone call? Anybody? Nobody. All right, when you have a 2% chance of getting hurt on the job, someone's got to make that phone call. So anyway, y'all can sort it out later. But that's the nature of a work environment which is hazardous, and the hazards actually present themselves. So here's what happened with Alcoa, is that in the late 1980s, they had a conversation, and wouldn't you know, they couldn't find any volunteers at all to get hurt. Nobody. And, you know, Chris didn't raise his hand. No one raised their hand. And no one volunteered to call Bota and say, hey, we heard Chris today. So I started having this conversation in terms of, well, what would be ideal? And they came to this understanding, well, if no one wants to get hurt, then the ideal is perfect. And then they started having some other conversations in terms of, well, let's think about the other things that go wrong here. You know, hey, we missed the shipment last week. We missed the shipment last week. That's not so good. We're probably going to miss a shipment next week. Does anyone want to volunteer for that? Call the customers and see if anyone wants to volunteer for that. Anyone want to volunteer, you know, late shipment? All right, well, you know, we had a shipment which it arrived on time, but the quality was wrong. The chemistry of the aluminum was wrong. Call up our customers and see if they want to be next. Like, guess what? No one volunteered. All right, so this goes on as Alcoa starts running through their list of performance metrics. Does anyone want to get hurt? No, no one wants to get hurt. Does anyone want a late shipment? No. Does anyone want a low quality shipment? No. Does anyone want an overpriced shipment? No. Does anyone want an incomplete shipment? No. So then when Alcoa is starting to think about their competitive situation, they realize that their goal really has to be perfect because they can't find any volunteers. They can't find any volunteers. Now, then there's a second question they have to ask. Now that they've got a goal of perfect, they have to get into the question of why are they imperfect? And the conversation goes something like this, which is the aluminum conspiring to hurt us? And wouldn't you know that no matter how long they lingered around over, you know, between shifts, overnight shift, they couldn't find the aluminum conspiring to hurt anybody. And then they went to the presses and they asked the presses, and the presses didn't volunteer that they were out there desirous of hurting anybody or being late or low quality. And they came to the appreciation that aluminum doesn't, and here's the thing, so this actually is an important point, as opposed to what else I might have been saying. The important point here is that when you start having the conversation with people at Alcoa and elsewhere about perfect, the first response is, well, you have to understand. You have to understand. And you have to understand is one of those phrases which, with all due respect, means you don't understand, you don't deserve respect, right? So anyway, and if someone says, with all due respect, you don't understand, they really think you're a fool and an idiot, right? So anyway, the conversation starts with the people who are advocating for perfect as the goal. They say, well, look, with all due respect, you don't understand. That's impossible because the aluminum is so hazardous. All right, so that's the starting point. But then they get into the conversation. What is it inherently in the aluminum that says the aluminum wants to, you know, wake up one morning and spatter us with molten metal or cut us with the sharp edge of a door frame? And no one could find any reason that the aluminum wanted to do that. So then they get to the further understanding, which is, if the aluminum is hurting us, it's not inherent to the aluminum or the aluminum processes or the transportation or the logistics or anything else. It's that people really didn't understand the aluminum. And that's why it's hurting them. That if they had perfect understanding of the aluminum, they'd be safe. And just imagine the situation. You know, you're walking up to one of these vast pots, it's got molten metal, and it starts bubbling, and it spatters on you. Whoa, I didn't see that one coming. Why didn't you see that one coming? Because I didn't know it was coming, right? So the key transition for Alcoa was to start viewing the world in a very, very different way. The world went from a place of great uncertainty because it was built to be uncertain to a place of great uncertainty because the world was not well understood. And when you go into this idea that the world is uncertain because it's misunderstood, aluminum stops being your adversary in terms of safety. The presses stop being your adversary in terms of safety. And your adversary is now the ignorance about those things. And it changes the mindset within the organization of really what we have to do is prepare ourselves to attack ignorance, not prepare ourselves to attack aluminum. So anyway, with that in mind, having defined perfect and recognizing that gaps between perfect and imperfect were due to ignorance, they realize, well, we have to recognize ignorance, like elevated blood pressure and like in the healthcare setting, we've got to be able to recognize ignorance so we can treat it. So they set up this rule within Alcoa, and it went something like this, that if someone got hurt on the job, the CEO of Alcoa, this fellow named Paul O'Neill, he wanted to know within 24 hours. Now, again, it's one of these things, right, which people say, well, you got to understand, that sounds like micromanagement. And it sounds that way, but here's the deal. In 1987, for Paul O'Neill to find out in 24 hours, he insisted he hear it from the president of the business unit in which that person got hurt. Now, I try to explain to my students that in 1987, to actually reach someone, they had to be sitting at a desk and pick up a phone, right? Right? And you had to do that from a desk which also had a phone attached, right? So you start running the cycle times on this. To tell Paul O'Neill in 24 hours as a business unit president, you needed to know within 18. And for you to know within 18, your vice president had to know within 16. And the assistant to the vice president probably had to know in 14. And we once did this. We were in Sao Paulo, Brazil, in an extrusion mill. We started trying to figure out all the layers that separated the guy running the press all the way to Paul O'Neill. It turned out there was 26. I guess for you guys, that'd be echelon 26, right? Is there an echelon 26 command? Anyway, so 26. And so we started figuring out how quickly would the guy have to complain that he had gotten hurt for Paul O'Neill to find out in 24 hours. And the answer was he had to complain before the pain set in. It had to be one of these like, well, I'm not really sure, but I better raise my hand. I don't see any blood or swelling discoloration, but I better raise my hand, because if I pause at all, he'll never find out and he'll get very angry. Now this whole 24-hour rule was set in place to create another rule, which is in 48 hours, Paul O'Neill insisted on finding out the initial diagnosis for the problem, what had you learned by its occurrence, and the initial treatment plan for the problem, what you had learned about better understanding of the aluminum and the processes it was going through. And again, this 48 hours thing wasn't because Paul O'Neill was the know-all, be-all, see-all, you know, kind of the Wizard of Alcoa kind of thing. It's that it was this insistence that if you had a problem and you wanted to understand it, you had to get on that problem right away. Because let's say you had metal that was spattering people and you showed up an hour later. The thing you're investigating is not the thing that was hurting people. It's something else. And you can come to a great understanding of that something else, but you're not going to come to an understanding of the thing that was hurting people. And if someone gets banged in the head by a boom, if you wait an hour or two or three or the next day to find out why you got hit in the head by a boom, the thing you're investigating is not the situation which caused him to get hit in the head. It's something else. So they set the sense of urgency around if your ignorance presents itself in the form of a hazard, get on it right away so you can come to some understanding of the situation and convert your ignorance as an adversary into a little bit of incremental knowledge as an ally. So then the folks at Alcoa are doing this, and they come to the realization that a problem experienced over here, someone says, oh man, you know, we're having the same problem over there. So what they start doing is formalizing this idea that if you learn something, either that a problem, a hazardous situation exists, or you have an even deeper understanding of why it exists and how to deal with it, prevent it from recurring, you know, make a point of teaching somebody. Because that's where you get this huge multiplier. Because if Admiral Kelly learns something and keeps him to himself, that's better for him. But if he learns something through his hard work and effort and all of that and shares it with all of us, look at the multiplier. We got, you know, one learning, 200 applications. And if the gentleman in the blue shirt, he learns something, keeps it to himself, I mean, that's good for him. But if the rest of us somehow benefit from it, one learning times 200. And so what you start seeing within Alcoa is they get this dynamic going, their performance all across the board starts getting better and better and better. And so in the case of safety, Alcoa went from a place where the chance of getting hurt on the job each year was about 2%, and they drove that number down to 0.07%. 0.07%. Now, at 0.07%, if I've done the math right, in this room, no one has to volunteer this year to get hurt. And in fact, I don't think anyone has to volunteer this decade to get hurt, which means that you're off the hook for having to call Chris's wife and explain that he got hurt, because he didn't. All right, so that's what happens in terms of safety when you go from 2% to nearly two orders of magnitude decrease in the chance of getting hurt on the job. Now, this is the point where most people interrupt and say, well, you have to understand with all due respect. And it's like, oh, it's, you know, yeah, hey, same to you, buddy, right? They say, well, you know, with all due respect, what you have to understand, you know, safety isn't free. Safety isn't free. That's the phrase. There's a cost to quality and there's a cost to safety. At times you get it framed in terms of, oh, there's this iron triangle. You know, you have safety and cost and quality, and you can pick two, but not all three. And normally you can only pick one, and you have to sacrifice on the other two. And let me dig into the logic of that a little bit. The logic there is that there is inherently, almost like built into the fabric of the universe, trade-offs. That, you know, no, sorry, you know, you can't pull on the safety lever without giving something up on the cost lever or the quality lever. If you want more quality, you know, it's built into the fabric of the universe that you have to give up on the other two levers. Now digging into that logic a little bit further, it strikes me as having a combination of great arrogance but also great pessimism. Because to have a situation where you say, look, you know, Admiral, I'm sorry, but you know, we can't get better on quality, cost, and safety. And the question is why? The answer has to be because there's nothing else that can be possibly understood about the situation, that everything that is known, I know about the situation. Now here's why that's, I mean, I think we recognize that sounds pretty arrogant. I know everything that possibly can be known. But it's also pessimistic, right? Because it basically says is that this situation, which is obviously presenting us with evidence of our own ignorance, I'm too stupid to figure out how to learn. All right, so when you get into this situation where you say, well, we want to get better on safety and, as opposed to safety or, recognize you're running into a whole bunch of conventional wisdoms. Well, you know, with all due respect, you really have to understand there's trade-offs. Well, anyway, no one told Alcoa. No one told Alcoa. So in the period when they went from a chance of getting hurt on the job of from 2% to 0.07%, they reduced their costs by about $100 million on an ongoing basis. Their on-time deliveries skyrocketed and delighted their customers. Their profitability went off the chart, and I forget, it was like a 10x increase in profitability over about a decade-long period. Remember, profitability is not just sort of bean counters, it's joy to the customer and being rewarded for that. And in terms of linking this really directly back to this whole thing about learning and converting ignorance into knowledge, it was really interesting. Through the late 1980s and probably into the early 1990s, if you looked at the stock price of Alcoa, it followed nearly identically the spot price for aluminum, which made sense. Alcoa owned a lot of aluminum. It'd be like if I had a bag full of Cougarans. You know, what's my net worth? Well, let's check the price of gold. By the way, I don't. Wish I did, but I don't. Anyway, aluminum goes up, the stock price of Alcoa goes up, aluminum goes down. And you see exactly the same thing if you were looking at Exxon or British Petroleum, Mobil. Price of oil goes up, their stock price goes up, the price of that petroleum goes down, the stock price goes down. Well, what happens with Alcoa is around 1993, 1994, there's a split where the stock price of aluminum continues to go up and down as the price of natural resources always goes up and down. And the stock price of Alcoa just goes up and up and up like a dot-com. Now you start thinking, why does the price of a dot-com or any high-tech venture capital startup go up and up and up? They're not being rewarded for the things they own, the physical stuff. They're being rewarded and priced based on the stuff they know, right? So anything that has a dot-com after its name back in the 90s and even today, it's not by the scarce resources they have, because the resources, the physical resources, are not scarce. It's by their knowledge of what to do with those resources to put them to good use that bring joy to others. And so in the case of Alcoa, the marketplace started looking at Alcoa not as the holder of vast amounts of raw material, but as people who incidentally owned a lot of raw material, but knew a whole lot more about what to do with it than anybody else in the world. And so while the Dow Jones Industrial, you know, crept up, Alcoa started to look like a Silicon Valley startup because it became a knowledge company and not a natural resources company. At least is how it was perceived in the marketplace. So there was one more rule that they instilled within Alcoa. Is when they started to realize that the way they competed was not by the stuff they had, but their knowledge of how to use that stuff and put it to good use. And they realized that the way to cultivate this knowledge, to grow this knowledge, was the discipline, everyone, everywhere, to do work in such a way as you could see what was wrong with what you were doing. When you did your work and saw something wrong, swarm on it to find out why you were wrong. And then when you learn something from being wrong or being slightly less wrong, a little bit righter, that you taught someone, they realized that fundamentally this is what the leadership objective had to be, the leadership priority had to be, was to build these capabilities into everyone everywhere. And this is in part why it resonated so strongly with the CNO statement about the world getting more complex and dynamic. Because in the case of Alcoa, they've got 200 facilities in 30-some-odd countries and tens of thousands of employees. So they're not quite as geographically spread out as all of you, but it's sort of same order of magnitude problem. And here's the other thing. You know, by and large, you have American sailors on board your vessels and in your stations. And the time that Alcoa was figuring out how to be such an aggressive learner across the full range of its operations, it bought the aluminum industry in Italy, and it bought the aluminum industry in the Eastern Bloc. Now if you start thinking about cliches or stereotypes of folks who really are concerned about precision and learning and excellence, all right, maybe the Swiss come to mind, and probably the Germans come to mind. And perhaps the Japanese, for sure the Japanese come to mind. But when you start in a list of, you know, companies which are known for productivity, quality, and operational excellence, I mean, I'm not sure Italy is on that list. No offense to Italians in the room. All right, but that's who Alcoa is proving out their ability. It's not just with the stereotypical nations and cultures where we think, oh, well, of course, you know, everyone knows, with all due respect, they do that well anyway. They're doing it in countries where no one has done it before. So anyway, this becomes the rule set for Alcoa over this period from 1987 through about 2000, where not only do they become impeccably safe, and in fact, they become the safest employer in the country. Let me just qualify or quantify that. They're safer than any hospital for staff. They're safer than any major research university in terms of staff. When I try to tell my friends who go into blue-collar work like consulting that if they decide to do a reorganization of their office, and in the course of moving a desk from one part of the office to the next, they pick up a box of paper and pull out their back and miss work the next day, their consulting firm is about 10x more dangerous than an Alcoa mill. All right, so Alcoa goes through this transition by applying these four very simple ideas, which is perfect is the goal, the adversary is ignorance. We discover adversary by looking for it, by seeking out problems. When we find a problem, we try to identify the problem, understand the problem, and resolve the problem. And as we go through that, we have to teach someone else. And we have to make sure we accomplish this everywhere all the time by making sure this is what leaders do in terms of developing the skills of other people. Now, here's the a follow-up on this. This all occurred under the tenure of Paul O'Neill. He was the CEO from 1987 through about 2000. And one might think, you know, well, with all due respect, everyone, you know, with all due respect, everyone knows that, or with all due respect, you don't understand that this is really about charismatic leadership, right? That's the other kickback you always get. Oh, that's fine for Apple, you know, Steve Jobs. That's fine for Alcoa, Paul O'Neill. But Paul O'Neill left in 2000. We're up to 2016. I checked with Paul the other day and said, hey, Paul, what's the injury risk at Alcoa today? You know what it is? 0.08. It hasn't budged. And he's had two successors in that time, maybe three in the 15 years he's been gone. I'm pretty sure he doesn't go into Alcoa facilities. I mean, I call him, he's never there. So he asked the question, what happened? Well, the thing is, in the period that he was CEO, he inculcated a certain set of values about behavior within his organization. And it was very strong values, which is if you're doing work, aspire to perfect. And when you do it, see any imperfection, get on it. And when you get on it and you've learned something, teach somebody else. So it's only three things, and then the fourth one is kind of the meta rule of just teach someone else to do this. But he inculcated these very, very strong principles, taught them through his fellow leadership, cascaded it out into the organization to the point that it became the organizational norm. And so there was a new CEO and a new CEO after that, and new business unit presidents, and new employees came, and some employees left, and they added new product, new process, but they kept coming back to what is fundamental to them, which is this dynamic of seeing problems and solving them to convert ignorance into knowledge, and then teaching somebody else. And because he came up with such a simple rule set and was absolutely adamant about inculcating it, Alcoa took this situation, you know, sprawling processes, sprawling products, sprawling markets, and made this very, very dynamic environment stable, or at least with the appearance of stability and reliability and agility that no one else in their sector could achieve. Now, anyway, I'll pause here because the rest of my story builds off of exactly the same script. So we could talk about Apple or Intel or Toyota or anyone else and say, well, how do they get so far ahead and stay so far ahead? And yeah, you know, the costuming is different. It's cars instead of aluminum ingots, or it's phones instead of cars. The costuming is different. And the cast may have different names, but the storyline is exactly the same. So anyway, let me stop here, because you haven't interrupted yet, so I'm feeling somewhat insulted. So, all right. All right, so you got it. There's got to be questions. Yes, sir.
Sir, Colonel Randy White, U.S. Army. Great talk. I think it's very applicable to the military. One of the questions I have, I've worked a little bit in the lessons learned industry in the Army, and I think we try to do this, probably nowhere near as well as Alcoa or Toyota, but we try to find things that we can learn and take it and spread it out. One of the problems that I've noticed is that we have so many lessons coming from so many different places that it's hard to figure out what is the key lesson
yeah.
and how to get that, what lessons we need to get out to the different units. Do you have a suggestion for how you could handle that on a large scale that you would have with something like the Army or the Joint Force and military as a whole?
Yeah, so the short answer is to your question, yes, I do. Next one, but here's what it is. So first of all, this is sort of the punchline to the presentation, but I'll give it now because I'm going to keep coming back to it. It's about see, solve, and share, and everything else is just detail around that. And the storyline goes something like this is... I'll save that story for the end. So sharing. So here's the thing. I've seen this in industry all the time. People say, we got to share knowledge. Got to share knowledge, all right? And so how are we going to share knowledge? We're going to create a knowledge base. And the knowledge base is a big electronic thing, but it's sort of, the metaphor sort of is like this giant cauldron, which if you learn something, you throw it in, and then I have to sift through it looking for it when I actually need it. Now, of course, that never works. And if you've ever been in an environment where they have these knowledge bases, one, the knowledge base is largely empty, and whatever in there, you wouldn't want to take out anyway. So the knowledge base becomes this huge monument to futility. Now, forgetting about knowledge bases for a second, there are communities which are really, really good at sharing. And so let me give you a particular example first. So I have a buddy I was working with, this guy Chris Kyoto, who's an orthopedic surgeon. So if you go into Chris's office, which he shares, he's got to practice with other orthopedic surgeons, in the waiting area they've got old copies of People Magazine and Us, not surprising, glossy copies of New England Journal of Medicine, which is no one has read, because no one really understands it. But here's the funny part. The doctors don't read it either. But if you go into Chris's office, he's got copies stockpiled of the Journal of Foot and Ankle Surgery. And those foot and ankle surgery journals, man, those things will leaf through. You can see he's read that several times. It's highlighted and it's marked up with pen, and he's got post-it notes in it. And occasionally he'll have an article ripped out and stuck on the board. And you start asking the question, why does he have such an intense interest in that journal? Well, of course, he's a foot and ankle surgeon. And so to stay on the cutting edge, pun not intended, he's a surgeon, but anyway, to stay on the edge of what he does, he's got to know what the latest and greatest is in terms of foot and ankle surgery. So he's got this huge incentive to read that journal. Now, there's another piece to it, which is, occasionally you'll check in with Chris or other guys like him, how things going. He says, great. I learned a lot from the last 50 surgeries I did. I wrote an article, and guess what? It's in the Journal of Foot and Ankle Surgery. All right, so Chris is working in this environment in which he has both incentive to extract from the journal and also incentive to put in the journal. All right, but there's another element, and this is, I think, often overlooked when you have these organizations create these knowledge bases. They figure, if I build it, they will come. Worked fine in a movie. But as I have to tell my kids sometimes, the movies are fantasy, right? If you build it, they won't come. What you have to do is design it and operate it and manage it. So the thing about a journal, and the reason that particular journal is so well read, is because it has an editor. And the editor, every single day, gets out of bed and says, oh my gosh, what's the community? What are the boundaries on that community? Who's in the community so I have critical mass? Who's outside the community so I have enough focus to get interest in the critical mass? So you have someone who worries about that. Then you have someone else who worries about the medium. Do we stay in print? Do we go online? Do we have online and in print? What's our refereeing process? All right, so you have someone who worries constantly about this journal as a mechanism for sharing knowledge. And continuing with the example of my friend, this guy Chris Kyoto, right? So he's got journals. Now, for other stuff which is not yet journal ready, maybe there's a conference he goes to. And again, there's incentives to go to the conference to hear what's even further on the cutting edge and to have an opportunity to get whatever benefit is there's from presenting. But again, with the conference, not like a bunch of people just happen to show up and meander and say, hey, what are you working on? Backs, don't care. right? He goes to conferences about feet and ankle. And how does that occur? Because there's a conference organizer who has a job almost identical to that of an editor, figuring out, well, who's the community? Who's the community of common interest? How do I get the community big enough that we have critical mass of new ideas? How do I keep the community small enough that we don't get diluted with extraneous topics? What's the medium? Where do we meet? When do we meet? Do we have poster sessions? Do we have plenaries? Right? So there's someone who sweats those details about who to connect and how to connect. All right, so and then in the case of Chris, you know, he's got his journal, he's got his conferences, he's got his seminars. For something that's really, really out there, maybe he invites people to watch him actually perform the surgery because there's nuance and subtlety which couldn't yet be captured in printed word. But again, there's someone who's managing that process of who gets invited, who doesn't get invited, what are the topics, where do they sit? They worry about the medium. So that's the case of the medical community and how they share knowledge, and the scientific community, engineering community is exactly the same. You've got this series of seminars and conferences and demonstrations and journals in which someone really sweats the details on who's in, who's out of the community, what does the community talk about, and how does the community talk to each other, with incentives and time to both contribute to and extract from the community's discussion. Now, let me continue this, is that when we think of other social institutions which are very, very effective at the sharing of knowledge, they have exactly the same properties of someone who worries about the community, its boundaries, its content, and its medium. So libraries, right? You know, and every town has its small library, but there's a librarian there who decides what books go in and what books don't go in the library. And then if you go to a university, you might have multiple libraries. And there's someone who has to decide what goes in the science library versus the engineering library versus the arts library, so on and so forth. And how is it presented? How is it cataloged? What are the hours? Right, because they have to worry about the community and the community's needs and how the community communicates. Museums work exactly the same way. It's not like, you know, a museum is just you throw all your junk in, like, my attic, right? A curator worries very much about who do we want to bring into the museum? Who do we want to appeal through the museum? What's the medium? How do we present the collection? Do we just put the stuff up there? Do we put it up there with explanation on the wall? Do we do audio tours? Do we have something online? They really sweat those details. All right, and you can go on, whether it's open source software or Wikipedia. You have those roles played in all those situations of the community boundary definer, the community having incentive to contribute and to extract, and someone worrying really with great passion about the media of exchange. So anyway, in terms of armies and lesson learned, let me kick it back to you. In terms of, we get so many lessons and we feel overwhelmed and we have trouble sharing it out. What part does it have of those features and what part does it lack?
Well, from the Army perspective, we have the Center for Army Lessons Learned, which is supposed to do the functions that you're describing, collate the lessons and try to put them together in different reports, push them back out to the community. The Joint Force also has a similar program, the Joint Staff, where you have the Joint Lessons Learned program. And they try to collate lessons and they push out to the force to try to make changes. But both organizations also have this huge lessons learned database. And you go in and you try to find a lesson because you may not be privy to the reports that are going on, or I think kind of more to your point you had before, reports may get sent out, but I don't know that they're necessarily organized in a fashion. So I know as an armor officer, these are the reports that I need to read. You just get a blanket push right on here's stuff out there. So that's probably something that could be improved. But if you go to the database, you've got a database that has hundreds of thousands of entries, and trying to pull from that and get information can be challenging.
Right. And if you start, so in the printed age, the editor worried about who subscribed, who didn't subscribe, they'd occasionally check in, did you subscribe and did you read the articles? Maybe they put in a promotion there, or at the bottom it said, you know, if you want to learn more, write a letter to this address. Now in the electronic age, they track that even more closely, right? In terms of who opens, who closes, who reads, how long did they dwell, what did they download, that sort of thing. They're constantly monitoring that. And again, without knowing your world, I guess, at all, what I would offer is the filter or the criteria of, for all this categorization and labeling, is there anyone actually managing through feedback? And actually, it took me a long time to get to it, but it's the same logic, right? Which is, we design something for the purpose of being useful. If we follow Paul O'Neill's rules, you know, about Alcoa, we should design it in such a way that we can see where it's being used, but even more precisely where it's not, and when it's not, find out why. So if we push something out to the field, we find people don't use it, do we follow that thing into the field and say, hey, why didn't you use that thing? And the answer is because it's about horses, and we don't have horses anymore, right? And that's a gross exaggeration. It's a gross exaggeration. But it's this question of the starting point of, I've designed something, and I have to assume the thing I designed won't work the way I hope. So what I have to do is find out when it doesn't work the way I want, the way I hope, so I can then recognize the ignorance I inserted, not deliberately, but inadvertently, recognize the ignorance I inserted into that situation so I can address that ignorance and convert it into something useful. So if these databases really had this dynamic of constant update, you know, constant self-checking, constant self-correcting, what you would see on the receiving end is a change in the profile of the stuff you got. You know, you'd say, hey, wait a second, hey, isn't that good? I don't get any more horse articles. I'm getting more armor articles. And not only armor articles, I'm getting the armor articles I need, whatever that happens to be, as opposed to the armor articles which aren't terribly relevant to me. So anyway, let me just offer this, is that I suspect right now you're thinking, oh, that'd be really nice and good, but I don't control the Army Lessons Learned Center. But here's the thing, back to the Admiral's challenge, is that you all are going back to some type of command. And maybe it's not command of all the entire United States Army. I mean, obviously for most of you that's not the case, right? But it's a smaller operating unit within this larger thing called the U.S. military. You still have the issue of people constantly are discovering things which are difficult, which you hadn't known would be difficult before you tried them. And you have people who are figuring out why those things are difficult, and they're learning something. And so when you go back into a command and say, wait a second, you know, I have soldiers, or sailors, or Marines, or airmen, recognizing things as indications of ignorance, I have to build up a platform for them to share what they've learned so everyone benefits from that experience. And when I say platform, I want to be very clear. I'm not talking about an IT platform. Oh, you know, go get this ERP system or whatever else. It might be a chalkboard if that's the right mechanism, if that's the right medium. It might be a whiteboard. It might be a PowerPoint, whatever it is. But I have to have someone who's managing the mechanisms for sharing, just like I have people who are managing the well-being of the tanks and the ships and the planes for which we're responsible. It is, and I'll stop here. But the mechanisms by which we share, which include the boundaries, the media, the incentives, those things are designed objects. They're not as designed as, let's say, this clicker or that phone, but they are designed objects. And they're designed to be used by someone else. By the fact that they're designed by us, to be used by somebody else, for sure we got something wrong in the design. And even if the design works in the moment, it'll stop working because the conditions and the situations change. So we need someone who's responsible for the not only the design, but monitoring the design and correcting the design all the time. And let me just offer one more piece. I didn't expect to give quite as long an answer. I start off with yes. But again, you know, I'm speaking way out of turn because I know your world minuscule amount. But my impression of what I know of your world is that you never take for granted that a situation you created is now stable forever. Right, that you create a situation and then you monitor that situation to see where that situation is changing in different ways due to internal dynamics, external dynamics. You're constantly on guard, as it were, to see when the situation is changing. And when it changes, you know, ideally you know sooner than later and react quicker than slower because of all these things. That if you react quicker and sooner, you'll have a chance to control the situation and prevent it from snowballing into a chaotic situation. Well, it's the same thing with a knowledge sharing device. It's a constructed artifact, and it's subject to all the disturbances of the world in which we live. And if it's subject to all those disturbances, it will stop working well. And so better to find out sooner and quicker than slower and later. Anyway, did that help? All right, thank you. Anyway, yeah, I think we got at least part of your homework done, right? You know, what do I do when I get back to command? Knowledge sharing with those criteria. All right, so some other question. I'll try to answer it in fewer words. Yes, ma'am.
Commander Emily Bassett, with Alcoa, did they have this concept of see, solve, share inculcated at every level? And the reason I ask that question is, you know, when you look at our military, there are some portions where we might be more like the professions that you described, and some portions of the military that are more bureaucratic, and I don't necessarily want everyone at every level creating their own solutions to what they see as a problem. And in the more bureaucratic sense of the military, there are times where I want people just doing what they're told and not always trying to solve what they insist to be a problem. So,
I just want to make sure I heard you. So there are people you want to see and solve problems, and other people you don't want. Or help me out that again.
Right. So my question is sort of the bureaucratic nature. Some portions of the military that are more bureaucratic in nature.
Right.
And the organizations that you gave examples were more professional organizations. So
we are talking people who make 70-pound rims for SUV wheels and stamping plants in Cleveland. I don't know. It's not White Shoe Law Firm in Manhattan. I mean, these are my people we're talking about here, right? So I may look professional how I dress, but the reason I wear a bow tie is not because of how it looks, but it doesn't get stuck in things that spin. I mean, so... I'm trying to find, where's my professional community here that's, I'm thinking, tea with the pinky up. I mean, that's not who we're talking about here. We're talking to people who, work in the line, so.
So that's my question. Is at every level, did that happen at even the most junior, I don't know if you could say junior to senior levels, but even at the most junior level and all those organizations?
Yeah, well, and I'm gonna tease you right now, but, all right, so understand, what I'm about to say is not really meant as an insult, I'm just pretending. But with all due respect, you don't understand. Right, but think about that, and you're being a good sport on this, but think about what you're channeling, which is the assumption that there are those of us in the world who are thinkers and smart and creative, and then there are those who are the doers. And said that way, thinkers, doers, really, it says those who are smart and those who are dumb. And actually, the thing you're saying, let me just rant on this for a little bit, there's actually a long history on that, right? So Frederick Taylor, he was the father of scientific management. And, what he said was about 50% right. What he said was, look, if you have a situation which is not behaving well, then you study it. And he had time and motion studies and clipboards and stopwatches. That was his artifacts, but you study it. And if you study it closely, like a doctor looking at a patient in an intensive care unit, you'll come to a better understanding. And if you come to a better understanding, you can manage the situation better than if you lack that better understanding. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant. But the other problem was that Frederick Taylor was a racist. I mean, the guy was disgusting. And if you read any of his testimony always talks, he always personalized it about the person who's doing the time motion study and the person who's shoveling the coal ash. And the person doing the time motion study has always got a nice Anglo-Saxon surname, Worthington, Huffington, this kind of thing. And the guy doing the shoveling is a guy named Schmidt. It's always Schmidt. And if he were working somewhere else, it would be Pergola or Schwartz. I mean, but it's always Schmidt who's doing the shoveling. And if you read through this stuff, Taylor's basic assumption is that guys like me, guys like me with, T and the pinky, we're good thinkers, which is good because guys like Schmidt are just dumb as a rock. All right, and so that's the attitude Taylor brought into this. And I think if half of it is brilliant, and half is absolutely disgusting, and I think completely undemocratic and un-American. I mean, every now and again, I read the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths: all men are created equal. Taylor didn't read that part. He didn't read that part. Now let's take this a step further in terms of who can do this. So, a quick answer to your question: did everyone in Alcoa do this? The answer, yes. All right, but the slightly longer answer is that. Yes, if you start with the assumption that problems reflect ignorance and that the way to deal with problems is convert ignorance into knowledge, then you have to also get over this other assumption, which some people can solve problems and other people can't. All right, and again, I know when we say it, it's like, well, yeah, of course, I believe that to be true. I read the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal. But we don't always actually practice that. Now, the folks who do, they get great results. So shifting it from Alcoa to a very tangible example with Toyota. So back in 1983, General Motors running a plant out in California near Oakland, Fremont, California. This plant was terrible. They set records. They had the worst quality in the country, the worst productivity in the country. Their absenteeism was 25%. They had recorded drug and alcohol abuse in the plant. They had prostitution practiced in the parking lot. And first-line supervisors carried weapons into the plant for personal protection. All right. So, not surprisingly, General Motors closed the plant down. All right. About a year or two later, they opened up the plant. And the deal was it was going to be a joint venture with Toyota. And so they open it up and they make, I think it was the Selleck at the time, and within about a year's time, that plant starts setting records again. So you might be thinking, oh man, absenteeism. No, their absenteeism was about 3%, which is about the rate of the common cold. And their quality is so good, they start winning all these J.D. Power Awards. And their productivity is simply off the charts, and they become arguably the most productive auto plant, final assembly plant in the entire country. Now here's the punchline. Of the people who worked in that plant, which was this beacon of resurgent manufacturing excellence in North America and the United States, 98% of them had worked for General Motors. It was rehab. Now let's start thinking through what the difference is. When you went to work for General Motors, what was your daily experience? You were being asked to make a product no one wanted. And even if you could somehow convince yourself that someone actually wanted that product, when you went to make that product, you knew for sure that you would have difficulty. And when you called out the problem about your difficulty, you knew no one would respond. All right, and actually, let me qualify this. So I had a buddy who'd interned at that for the summer. His job was final inspection. And when the cars came by, he inspected them, and his job was to put a sticker on the rear window to say, hey, this car passed. You know, quality is job one or whatever. So anyway, the cars are going by, and he doesn't put stickers on all of them. So his boss says to him, where's the sticker? He said, well, you know, you told me all about this quality thing, and we should inspect all the cars, and if they pass, they get a sticker, and if they don't pass, they don't get a sticker. And the superintendent starts wagging his finger and says, don't be a wise-ass college boy. So then he realizes he's supposed to put stickers on the car and not really inspect for quality. So a couple of days go by, and his boss comes by and says, hey, where's the sticker on that car? He said, well, what am I supposed to do with the sticker again? He says, you inspect the car, inspect in sort of air quotes, and then put the sticker on the rear window. And he takes the guy and says, where's the window? No window. You know, don't be a wise-ass college boy. So then this fellow realized that his job was not to inspect for quality and call out aberrations. His job was to put stickers on windows. So he got the roll of stickers, and he just started stickering the windows on the cars all the way back to where windows were installed. And then he'd sit down and read his textbook for college. And then one day he had a genius insight. He walked back, and he found in receiving where the windows came in. And he just went, sticker, 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 sticker. And 30 minutes later, he had done a day's worth of work of stickering, right? So anyway, that was the GM setting. Now remember the transition. That was how things were operated to this change of this sort of thing, which is you inspected the car and it has a blemish on it. Oh my gosh, it's terrible. What did we do? How do we create a situation like that? Let's find out. Or putting a seat in a car and you realize, oh man, I'm supposed to have 4 bolts. I only have 3. Call for help. You know, hey, Steve, you know, what's the matter? I can only grab 3 bolts, not 4. Oh my gosh, I'm sorry. Did we not train you well? Are we presenting the bolts in a bad fashion? The glove on your hand to prevent cuts, does it make your dexterity compromised? Let's figure that, you know, at the end of the shift, let's have a conversation about that, do some experiments, and convert that ignorance we had about the design of your work into something more reflecting deeper knowledge. Now, so that's the transition, right, which is you know you're going to fail every day to going to a situation where you know you're likely to succeed, and if you don't, you'll correct on it so tomorrow you're even more likely to succeed. So on that theme of what's the environment in which people are working, I'll just tell one. So a woman comes up to this guy, Gary Convis. Gary was site president at this joint venture. And is it like a company barbecue or cookout or whatnot? She comes up at the end of the day and says, are you Mr. Convis? Yes, I am. Do you run this facility? Why, I do. What can I do for you? What'd you do with my husband? He said, what? What'd you do with my husband? Where is he? And he looks around and says, I don't know. Who's your husband? He says, no, he's not here. I haven't seen him for 6 months. And he says, what? He said, why are you telling me about your husband who's been missing for 6 months? And she says, well, I want to tell you something about my husband who I haven't seen in 6 months. When that guy used to come home from work, he'd come home and he'd plop down in his lounge chair and he'd turn on the TV and he'd say in some very insulting, offensive way to get him beer out of the refrigerator, and he'd drink a 6-pack or 2 6-pack of beer and pass out in front of the TV. And maybe he made it to bed that night, maybe he didn't make it to bed that night, but the next morning he just sort of grumbled out of the door and went back to the factory, and the cycle kept repeating every day, every day, every day. And you can imagine Gary Convis is looking at her, still wondering, what he's supposed to do about the husband who's been missing 6 months. And so he asked her, what am I supposed to do about this? She says, well, let me tell you, there's a new guy coming home. And he looks pretty much like my husband, but it's a remarkable difference. When he comes in, he says, hey, honey, oh, did you get a haircut today? And what are you cooking? It smells wonderful. Can I help? Oh, you're done. I'll do the dishes so we can go out for a walk later. And Gary is still staring at her, wondering what he's supposed to do with this situation. So he asks her, what am I supposed to do? She says, oh, nothing. Keep the old guy. I like the new one. And to your question, is this everyone everywhere? The answer is yes, right? Because nothing had changed in that facility except for how those senior treated those junior. So in the old days, it was about command, control, compliance, audit. And if things went wrong, the person who experienced the problem, who was sort of the nerve ending of this very large system, that person got punished for detecting something about the system which was wrong. I mean, it'd be like this. If your finger touched something hot, smacking your finger, bad finger for detecting heat, bad finger for detecting sharp, right? I mean, that'd be ridiculous, right? But that's what's happening in that kind of environment, command, control, audit, compliance. And what had they done? Well, they said, all right, well, we have this very complex system. It's tens of thousands of parts, and you know, who knows how many dozens and dozens of suppliers spread out all over the country. We're subject to weather and union grievances in the local ports, this and that. Things are going to go wrong all the time. What we want to do is actually reward people for calling out problems and ask them, oh, thank goodness, because you know that thing we didn't know about, now at least we learned that there's something we don't know about. Now we can start dealing with that. Now we can start dealing with that. We're going to engage you with this. Now, and again, I just want to play against what's sort of a conventional wisdom, which is, oh, you need to empower the workforce because they know the answers. And he started really building that out. It's like, all right, empower the workforce. They know the answers. So if they know the answers, why do they still have the same problems? I mean, are they masochistic? It's like, yeah, I know how to do this easy, but I really like the carpal tunnel. Right? No. I know how to do this easy, but the rotator cuff, I really want to get one of those cool things because when I have my arm propped up like that, I get disability and I can put a beer in it. I mean, no one says that. I have a friend who just got appointed a social security judge, you know, disability. I asked him, Alex, has anyone ever come in? He says, no. So I got it on an authority, right? No one ever says that. All right, so here's the thing is it's not that people doing the work know the answer, but people doing the work know the problem, and people doing the work can validate the answer. Say, yeah, you know what? That's easier. Oh, that's faster. That's simpler. And guess what? Your customers can do the same thing in the industrial world, which is they can say, yeah, you know what? I'm telling you what's wrong with your product, and I'm actually validating or refuting your new design. Now, so you start thinking about the situation of these wildly complex, sprawling, dynamic networks. Of course you want to engage the people out on the, you know, in the industrial world. It's, you know, by the patient bedside or, you know, at the customer, you know, at the tactical edge is, you know, how I learned it, you know, from Army friends, you know, at the tactical edge. Of course you want to listen to that because that's the first indication of something's going wrong. Why would you not listen to that? Because that's the sooner, faster, more frequent indication of an abnormality. It'd be like, you know, that picture of the ICU I showed you before, which is, don't listen to that alarm. You know, I mean, really, the elevated heart rate, the depressed heart rate, how serious can it possibly be? Right? You know, or kick the alarm. It's interrupting our conversation. I don't want to listen to that monitor beeping. Well, you don't do that, right? And so in this situation also, again, the short answer to your question, is it everyone everywhere? Yes. But not in these ridiculous fashions, but in this engaged fashion. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Aaron Ayers, United States Navy. Thanks for coming tonight. I had a question. How did Alcoa balance having standard procedures from localized procedures across such a large bureaucratic organization?
Right. So let me connect your question about standardized procedures with his question about lessons learned. And I'll give you a very particular example, but it applies to Alcoa also. So I mentioned installing seats in cars. The reason for that is before I got to go study Toyota, they said, go work somewhere else. I worked on a line putting seats in cars. And you know, I got to understand how difficult that work was and what it made it easier, what made it harder. So anytime I went into a Toyota facility, you know, I'd look at stuff and it'd be interesting. Oh yeah, it's kind of interesting how you put the doors on and how you put in the wiring. But the only job I really had an appreciation for was seat installation. So I'd go up to people and say, hey, can you show me how you put a seat in a car? And they'd show me how they put in a seat in a car, and it was a whole lot better than I did. And anyway, there's a whole set of cars about from 15 years ago. Don't go in the front passenger seat. I'm just saying, all right? Maybe three, maybe four, and you know, we're not sure about the torques. They say, hey, can you show me how you put the seat in the car? And they take the seat off the hoist and put it down and then get the four bolts and tighten them up and then put on some trim. And I knew Toyota was famous for standard work. So I'd say, oh, can you show me the standard work for that? And they take out, and just imagine this exaggerated, they take out a loose leaf binder, which is about 3 inches thick. And like 100, 150 pages. And I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. 150 pages to put a seat in the car? I mean, how many steps is it? It's like 21 steps, 15 steps. I mean, really, how can you get... And the guy said, oh, no. This page is how we do the standard work to put a seat in the car. I said, well, why 150 pages? He said, because this is how we were doing it yesterday, but it didn't work so well. Because over here, it really was difficult. I had to really reach with my left, and it didn't work so well. So we changed from yesterday to today. That's how we're doing it. I said, well, so the other page, oh, this was the day before. And the day before that, it was like this. And as he went through, and I said, well, what's all the way at the bottom? Oh, here, this is how we did it on the first day, but man, that stunk. We only did it for 20 minutes. Then we found it. We had to figure out a better way from that. All right, so in terms of the standard work, the thing I want to emphasize, because again, you know, it's one of these things, well, everyone knows that standard work has to be bureaucratic and dictated and that sort of thing. But in the folks who do this well, standard work is not standard forever. I think it's more appropriate to call it the temporary standard. And the temporary standard is a declaration of what you think will work, and you use it until you find out it doesn't. And when you find out it doesn't, why keep using it? Modify it. And so in the case of Toyota or Alcoa or these other great organizations, their standard work is not command, control, audit, compliance. Their standard work is an experiment. It's a declaration of belief. I believe if I do my work this way, it will easy and I will bring joy to somebody else. And if I find out that if I do my work this way and I don't, it's not easy or I don't bring joy to someone else, I better find out why and improve on it. And so the standard work within Toyota was 150 pages. And if you wanted to understand how they got to the way they're doing it in that facility, you could leaf through and say, oh yeah, I guess they tried it that way. Ooh, but look at that one. Oh, that was, should have seen that one coming, you know, on and on. Now connecting this to a big organization. So I think sometimes people think in terms of standard work and knowledge sharing and all of that is that the way you do your work has to be the way I do my work. But the thing is, when you go buy a car, you don't actually care how the work was done. I mean, it could have been a leprechaun riding a unicorn. You simply don't care. You want the final result to be consistent so that when you buy a Camry, you get a Camry and not, you know, Steve's Camry or your Camry or Jamie's Camry. You want a Camry with whatever that means in terms of quality and cost and features and functionality. So if we have a starting point of this is how I put a seat in a car, which says, hey, you know what, and again, back to this issue, we've created a community of seat installation. And so I'm going to give you my best known approach for putting a seat in a car. And the point here is not that you do it my way, but you use it as a starting point and modify it for yourself. Now, let me just step out of this world back into healthcare. So there's this guy in Salt Lake City named Terry Klemmer. And Terry is famous for the quality of care in his intensive care units. And the causality is these protocols he's developed. He's got tons of protocols. How do you control blood sugar levels? He's got a protocol. How do you control body temperature? Protocol. He's got protocols for everything. It's kind of like standard work, kind of like procedure maybe in your world. So Terry stands up and he's giving a talk. He said, well, here's the thing about the protocols. They work really, really well. Our mortality rates are, you know, 1/10 for similar conditions as to other intensive care units. I mean, they work great. And he says, you know, and here's the other thing, is that, you know, our protocols, they're not private. We put them up on the internet. And if you want to read our protocols, you can. If you want to use our protocols, feel free. And then after this whole buildup about the power of the protocols as a guide towards getting really good patient outcomes, he says, but here's the warning. You can take our protocols and use them, but they won't work. They'll be a disaster for you. And so anyway, the audience is like, huh, what's Terry talking about? He just told me the whole key is the protocols. He said, well, yeah, the whole key is the protocols, but here's the thing. Our protocols fit us because we've been tailoring them. And we started off with what we thought was our best possible understanding based on what the scientific literature told us about controlling all these vital measures in very sick patients. And so we wrote up a protocol, and we tried to adhere to the protocol. And wouldn't you know, the protocol was really difficult. So we changed it. And then we tried the protocol again. And it didn't work. So we changed and we tried the protocol again and we realized, you know, it worked great for the attending physician who's experienced and maybe for the fellow, but boy, the new residents, they couldn't follow those protocols also. So we had to make another protocol on how to train on the protocol. And so, and Terry's point was he had all these protocols, but like the Toyota had to install a seat. Obviously a very different situation, right? Four bolts versus, you know, the well-being of a human being. The protocols were temporary protocols. And in terms of what is the source of Terry's success managing his intensive care unit, really it's not the protocols. It's the discipline to develop them in the first place as a declaration of what you think will work, the discipline to recognize when they're not working, and the discipline to continually modify them. And that's his success. So now you tie it back to how do you share it across a community. So Terry puts up his protocols. Right, and it's not because he expects other people to use it identically, but he puts up his protocols and explains how they were developed. Well, you know, we tried this on the first day, but we ran into this difficulty, so we made a modification. We tried this on the second day, but ran into another difficulty. So we tried this, and we went back to that one. Then we went forward again, and he takes people through the whole process of discovery leading to the protocol. Now, along that way, there's some very important science and very important human factor stuff that's discovered. But really, when Terry shares, what he's really modeling is not the temporary solution. What he's modeling is the behavior to arrive at a continuing set of solutions that get better and better even as the situations change. Did that help? Cool. All right, so I'll stop. He nodded in such a way that it was both a yes and a yeah, and shut up already. So, all right. Yes, sir, over there.
Good evening, sir. Lieutenant Commander Rob Hamilton, U.S. Navy. So I'm trying to think of this as kind of a process where, say, for instance, you have an input where a problem is identified, and the output is, let's say, you know, some form of a practice that's put in place or a journal article in an ankle and foot surgery journal. But not all inputs are created the same. There are going to be some that just don't cut it. So how do you separate the wheat from the chaff, set thresholds for what actually makes it into the process and gets kicked out as a product, and all the while not disenchant the folks who are providing input who don't end up with a journal article in the end process?
Right. So the question is, given that the world is filled with a lot of variation on what comes into a process, how do you manage the process in such a way that it behaves in a way that seems consistent? And so... It's got to be you add process, right? Which is if you discover a problem, which is, I've got a way of screening and selecting people. But wouldn't you know, people actually get through those screens and then they arrive, whether it's at a university, a college, training, whatever else it happens to be, and they're really not ready. Oh, I got to go back and figure out how did I recruit, how did I attract, how did I screen initially? Because I'm getting the wrong people into that situation. Let's say you think you're getting the right people into the situation, and then as they go through the process, you know, you take a check, and some people have acquired certain skills to a certain level and other people haven't. What do you do then? Son of a gun, you know what? I've got one form of training for different types of people. I need to have some adaptation on that. So long and short is that the common theme all the time is this issue of do something to generate feedback. The feedback is, I don't know what I'm doing. And when I recognize I don't know what I'm doing, try to at least learn a little bit better and then feed that forward to the next cycle. And just keep an eye on the time. I just want to emphasize, because all the examples, I think most of the examples we've had are things which sound like fairly low variety, high volume, repetitive kind of stuff. And here's the one thing I just want to offer, is that stuff that's repeatable and low variety, that you can figure out by trial and error. I mean, when I started putting seats in cars, I wasn't very good at it. Actually, I was pretty awful at it. I eventually got it. I could put a seat in a car and pretty competently because I had enough practice. It was like every minute or two, a car came by, you know, and if you do that for 8 hours a day, you got 450, you know, chances to get it wrong and 450 chances to figure out how to do it right. The places where trial and error is really going to fail you is where you get very few shots at it. And the thing you're trying to do is very, very complex. And there's a lot of different parameters. And that's where the discipline is even greater required. See, and again, we tend, you know, this is like everyone knows, you know, with all due respect kind of thing. is that everyone knows that this sort of discipline around declaring what you think is going to happen when you act, and then quick feedback, oh, that applies for discrete part manufacturing and things which happen all the time, like blood draws in a hospital. But, you know, I do really complex work. Well, the thing about the complex work is that you only get one shot at it sometimes. You only get to do Whipple surgery on a patient with pancreatic cancer one time. So you really want to find out, you know, very, very quickly whether you're progressing in the right direction or the wrong direction. Well, how do you find that out? Well, you go through an elaborate process of declaring what you think is going to happen in the course of the surgery and figure out how you're going to detect aberration very, very quickly so you can contain and course correct immediately. Because you don't get another shot on that patient who's very, very sick. You're building something like a new building downtown Boston. Yeah, there's a lot of skyscrapers. This one is unique, though. And so you really have to have discipline around that one to declare in advance, what do I think we're going to do today? And can I see something going wrong? Because this is not the kind of thing where through trial and error and, you know, it's fairly, if things go wrong, what's the big deal? I'll just put a window in the car later on. I don't have that opportunity. So it's actually the stuff which is complex, the stuff which is idiosyncratic, the stuff which is unique, the stuff which is one shot. That's where you have to have this discipline even more. Because in the cases like that, if you don't have this discipline of declaring what you expect to happen and the discipline to find out when you're wrong quickly, then what you end up having is the Leaning Tower of Pisa, right? Because by the end, it's too little, too late. Do we have time for one more, or should I say goodbye? Sure, one more. All right. Yes, sir.
Evening, sir. My name is Steve Cornett. It seems to me that the most important aspect of the methodology you have up there is actually number four, the leadership part. One, two, and three almost seem to be a methodology. Four is, you know, my understanding here is a, you know, developing a culture of top-down leadership, involved leadership, that that it sets metrics and makes this whole thing work. My question is, did you find in your case studies that this was a top-down driven thing that caused this success, or was it a bottom-up?
Yes, so it's a great question on which to end, particularly with this audience. So again, the answer is yes. And I'll elaborate, and I'll do it with some sensitivity to the time this time. So here's the thing, is that you get people say, oh, well, you know, it's all about empowering the frontline workers. And yeah, there's actually a lot of value to that. And what we have to do is let them be to their own creative devices. But here's the thing, and you all know this, is that the young people are not the ones who establish the culture, because they're in an environment where there's punishment, reward, and incentives, and models, and examples, and all that sort of thing. They don't set the culture. They adapt to the culture, and they internalize the culture, and eventually they can propagate the culture and continue the culture, but they certainly don't set it. Who sets the culture? It's a senior person. It's a senior person by their daily interaction with other people. They establish what the values of the organization are. I got into a huge argument the other day. You get a sense I get into a lot of arguments with doctors on this because it's terrible. But anyway, they're saying, oh, what we have to do is change the culture so we can change the behavior. And I was like, are you an idiot? I mean, whoever heard of that you change the culture? Hey, let's sit down and have a discussion around culture. You know, how do you feel about the culture? Well, you know, the Master Chief, you know, I feel this way about the culture. You know, how do you feel about the culture? I'm going to tell you how I feel about the culture. The way you change culture is you act, right? You know, you act, and then people say, oh, look how he's acting. Oh, he's done it again and again and again. Oh, now I get a sense of his values. And if I want to get along, then I should act in a way which is complementary with the way he or she is acting. Oh, wouldn't you know? This is starting to reflect my values because I act this way all the time. And I keep going. And wouldn't you know, now we've got everyone linked all the way down. So let me just tie this up with a very tangible example. So when we got involved with Alcoa, and they were trying to take this issue around safety to everything, there was a rule in Alcoa that people would teach other people how to do this, but they would only teach through the leader. They wouldn't go to the shop floor. Because if they went to the shop floor, yeah, they could move machinery around and they can come up with a new version of standard work and all of that, but they couldn't change the fundamental belief system, the culture, and the behaviors. So the deal was, if you wanted help from their subject matter experts, you had to have a buy-in from at least six layers away from the shop floor, and the client all the time was that guy, typically that guy, occasionally a gal, but that guy. And at first, it was typically not the whole plant all at once, because the thing was you had to change the behavior of that guy and the people to whom he provided support and the people who felt that they had to answer to him. So typically, it was around a very small footprint, but a very long leg. And the reason for that is you wanted to give people this chance for very, very frequent reinforcement of a new set of behaviors to express a new set of values. And then once you got that going, you created this incubator, this you get some critical mass going, then you could get this infectious effect, but it had to start from the top. And it was a pretty good prediction for us, which is, where will this work? Tell us how high we can go in the organization and what their span of authority, responsibility, control was, and it'll work up to those boundaries, and it'll work no further. So it is top down. And again, there's the element of the bottom up, because you need that collective cognition going on, error detection, solution validation, collaborative input and all that. But if the senior leader doesn't do this, no one else will, and this is why it didn't work at General Motors. Because, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, but they didn't themselves, and because they didn't do it themselves, 25% absenteeism and all the other horrors there. Anyway, I guess I'm done. So thank you.